So this is who I was arguing against. This is a world famous skull-based surgeon right here. Of course, here's the stereotactic radio surgeon. So vestibular schwannoma is acoustic neuromas. We usually refer to them as acoustic neuromas, but they're really vestibular schwannomas. They're benign tumors. They arise from the Schwann cells of the vestibular nerve. So the vestibular nerve is part of the eighth nerve complex, goes to ear, basically the cochlea and the semicircular canals, and those are how we maintain balance in hearing. And then the seventh and eighth nerve complex is paired at the brainstem, so the seventh and eighth nerves are stuck together. They look like sort of one nerve in one sense, because they're stuck together. And so they go hand in hand. It's a totally benign tumor in one sense, in that it's not kind of metastasized or goes somewhere else in the body. The incidence is about 1 out of every 100,000 people, so I would say the DNA probably has about a 2 million person population that we draw from. And so in our practice, we probably see somewhere between 10 and 20 of these a year, would be my guess, for you to relate to these kind of numbers. You say, well, what's the difference between incidence and prevalence? The prevalence is much higher because these, the life expectancy of someone with an acoustic neuroma is pretty normal. And so they live a long time, and so the prevalence is much higher. About 1 in 5,000 people have these tumors. And so they're not terribly uncommon. I think they, depending on what the literature that you read, they constitute about 6% of the tumors that we treat in the brain. Symptoms include hearing loss, tinnitus, balance disturbance. These are all symptoms that are very serious, but neurosurgeons tend to minimize these symptoms because there's not a lot that we can do for them. And we focus on some of the bigger problems these patients can have. But again, we don't want to minimize even these symptoms themselves. Tumor progression can lead to brainstem compression, cranial neuropathies, and hydrocephalus, where you accumulate spinal fluid in the brain. There's really three treatment or algorithms. You can observe these patients, you can take them out, and that's what Dr. Bauer argued for, or you can do stereotactic radiosurgery. So we could have had actually a third person in this debate, and that would be the person supporting observation alone as a treatment strategy, and that would be reasonable. Vestibular schwannoma, here's a quick little picture. You can see the tumor back in here coming off of the seventh, eighth nerve complex. This is what the MRIs look like when they show up in the office. A lot of these patients have some hearing loss, and they're somewhere between the ages of 30 and 60, and they go to their audiologist, they notice some hearing loss, and they get an MRI, and it may look like this, and they get referred to us as surgeons. And you can see the tumor right here. This is a axial T1 post-contrast image human brain demonstrating a large, roughly a 1.8 to 2 centimeter mass in the right CP angle. Here's a coronal T1 image of the human brain without contrast, and the sagittal T1 image of the human brain demonstrating the same tumor. This is the very type of tumor that we're debating about, are these medium-sized vestibular schwannomas. Why is there controversy? There are no studies that are prospective and randomized, and they're just not going to occur. There have been several study designs to do this, but no one wanted to be randomized. If you have one of these in your brain, do you want to roll the dice as to what kind of treatment you're going to get? Most of you don't. You want control, and you want to talk to your surgeon and decide. The controversy are the medium-sized tumors. So they're different. This is sort of out of place, but have you ever you know, had the key fob battery die. And you're like, oh my God, I can't get into my car. And then you realize that you can open the door to the car with the key. But it's still a disaster. So this is a problem that I think all of us have run into with our vehicles. And it does sometimes make you want to cry. You don't see how life can go on until you get a new battery. But then there are other types of problems that you can run into with your car. And this is considerably worse. And they're both serious problems and emotionally disturbing, as you can see. You don't want to act like some sort of savage. But this is a much bigger problem. And so when we're talking about patients, with acoustic neuromas, balance disturbance and hearing loss are sort of this problem, although hearing loss is maybe closer to the other problem, but balance disturbance, headaches, is this type of problem. Facial nerve palsy is this problem. That is an unbelievably disabling problem for people. And it can't be overemphasized what a negative impact that has on their quality of life. We use our face to communicate with people, and it has everything to do with your social interactions, whether we like it or not. And when your face doesn't work, things are very, very difficult. Profound facial nerve palsies actually can lead to visual disturbance and loss of vision even in the ipsilateral eye, because you don't close your eye, and when you sleep you get corneal abrasions. So this is the problem with facial nerve palsies. So let's talk about the surgical resection for just a minute. I guess this is a laser. So the good news is that physicians, neurosurgeons can take out total tumor removal is possible in about 95% of patients. That's wonderful. That means of the 20 people right here, only one of you could it not be totally removed. Although this is a bit of a misnomer, because when we say total, a neurosurgeon many times doesn't mean total. We just mean that the MRI looks good. We don't remove tumors the way other surgeons remove them, where we remove them en bloc, chop out the lobe of the lung, put it in a bucket, and that's not how we work. We peel them. He showed these wonderful videos. We peel them off nerves. And he even showed you a case that he did where he leaves the tumor, a lot of it, behind to preserve the facial nerve. So total tumor removal is a little bit of a misnomer, but yet that is a wonderful fact. Oh, I see what I'm doing here. I'm going to drive you all crazy.
Not that hearing loss that you're causing.
Causing remarkable hearing loss. So from there, from that statement down, things get much worse. Normal or near normal facial nerve preservation with surgery is really only possible in about 80% of people. This is a terrible statistic. So if I could have, of those 20 people, maybe Chris, in your row, can you raise your hand, all three of you? And, well, how about all four of you right there in that row? Just raise your hand. So of the 20 people that we were going to operate on with microsurgery, 80% of them were good. That sounds good. But those four don't have good facial nerve function after surgery. That's not so good. I mean, that means those four people for the rest of their life have a very high price to pay for their decision to have surgery. Hearing may be preserved in even less. So if I could have maybe all of you raise your hands, all of you raise your hands, all of you raise your hands, and then these people in the front, y'all can sit there quietly. I need y'all to raise your hands. So those people lost their hearing with surgery. So, like, you're deaf. That's not so good. And I minimize that as almost putting hearing loss into that more minor category when I was showing you those ridiculous pictures about carpal tunnels, because neurosurgeons in our terrible world that we live in, there's not anything we can do to help you. We sort of write that off. Well, we lost hearing. That's a big deal. You lose hearing in that area. The best candidates for microsurgical resection are also the best candidates for stereotactic corneal surgery. And then surgery brings with it some other unique side effects. They're not totally unique. Headaches are common. I think we have a headache discussion coming later. This is really making a lot of noise. I'm sorry. But headaches do occur in about one-third as many people that get stereotactic radiosurgery. That's not on the slide, but headaches are pretty common after someone operates on you and does a craniotomy. So he showed all these terrible pictures of hair loss, including my hair loss. And what he didn't show you is that people have come in after their retrosigmoid and they're constantly complaining of pain at the surgical side. They have this little sharp edge of bone here, and they constantly complain that that this hurts all the time. They can't lay on it, and they're unhappy. And then 10% of them, so of these 20, maybe the in the front row here, you two raise your hands. Two of the 20 got CSF leaks and required extended stays in the hospitals, lumbar drains, multiple surgeries to fix the leak, infections. So surgery definitely comes with a price. Stereotactic radiosurgery is a non-invasive technique that delivers high-dose radiation. We don't put you inside a nuclear blast. But you lay on a table and you get outpatient treatment for the tumor. And it's usually pretty successful for tumors up to 3 centimeters. The Cochrane review that he brought up is absolutely true. There's absolutely no randomized controlled trials. And the take-home message here is that what you do with your acoustic neuroma is between you and your neurosurgeon. And you need to have a conversation with your treatment team. And also what our radiation oncologists think is really important. So it's a team approach between the patient and their physician. This is a great study because that came out, published last year out of NYU, two neurosurgeons. So it's just two neurosurgeons, one that sort of was the surgeon more often than not, and the other favored radiosurgery. And they looked at 399 of their patients, and then they put together in retrospective fashion three cohorts. And so what they wanted to do was look at hearing preservation in matched cohorts. So they matched for age and tumor size. And they were able, out of the roughly 400 patients that they looked at, they got 21 pairs to look at hearing preservation, 83 pairs to look at facial nerve preservation, and intervention-free survival and complication rate in 85 pairs. So they grouped together groups of people that were well-matched, and then they looked at how they did. Now, what I liked about this study is that it, in one sense, is non-biased. You have one of the guys involved is really a pro-surgery guy, and he's writing the paper with a stereotactic radiosurgery guy. And so they both have their own biases that hopefully sort of cancel out. But this is what they found. So looking at unilateral lesions that were small, less than 2.8 centimeters, because again, I've conceded the big tumors to Dr. Bauer, that they have to come out. If you've got this monster tumor pushing on your brainstem, you have to have surgery. So the controversy exists with the small to medium-sized tumors. And when it comes to hearing, class A hearing status was his class one status that he brought up, but that's really very useful hearing. Class A and class B hearing is still functional. So if you can talk to someone on the phone, you have class A, class B hearing, but more normal hearing, it's not perfectly normal, but more normal hearing is class A hearing. And in 14.3% of those who had normal hearing and had microsurgery continued to have normal hearing afterwards. It's like these are like famous neurosurgeons, and he is too. But this is like what they do, and only 14% of their patients who had surgery preserved their normal hearing after surgery. So that's not very good. If you had stereotactic radio surgery and you had normal hearing, then 43% maintained normal hearing afterwards. That's like a lot better, like three times better. Serviceable hearing, so this is the lower threshold. So if you showed up with serviceable hearing, it was preserved in about 43% of those who had microsurgery. So after surgery, you could still hear, and the neurosurgeon was super happy that he took out the tumor. It is a victory in neurosurgery to take one of these out and preserve hearing. And this number is very consistent across multiple papers. So 43% continue to have good hearing. If you use that lower standard, again, by a twofold margin, stereotactic radio surgery is better. The odds of you getting treatment and preserving your normal hearing or serviceable hearing was twice as good with stereotactic radio surgery. One limitation study that he would bring up if I let him rebut me is that in this particular paper, their follow-up for stereotactic radio surgery was shorter. And if you, it was like half as long. And so if you followed the stereotactic radio surgery patients with hearing loss out further, this number might be a little bit lower. And in fact, it has to be a little lower, so it might not be quite so significant. This is really the breaker. This is what favors stereotactic radio surgery over surgery. Is when you look at the Hals-Breitmann scores of facial nerve function, and we don't need to go over Hals-Breitmann, but the point is that there are varying degrees of facial nerve injury, and if you showed up and had microsurgery, 11% of those who had microsurgery had very significant facial nerve dysfunction. Grade 3, 4 Hals-Breitmann scores are not good. And so this means your facial nerve's not working so well in 11% of those. 0% of the SRS cases had poor facial nerve function. Basically, you can see here in the microsurgery cases, there's a big change in those that undergo surgery. And this can't be overcome. It doesn't mean your surgeon stinks. It just means that you have a terrible disease. And a certain percentage of those that elect to do surgery, you're going to wake up after surgery and your face isn't going to work. And many of them, you will see improvement. That's true, but in some you do not, and that is one of the major problems with surgery. When you looked at the intervention-free survival of these two groups of patients, they were actually matched. So he brought up sort of briefly in his talk, what if you get radio surgery and then it doesn't work and then you have to get surgery? Well, those patients are harder to operate on. Well, in this study, this modern study that was just published, when they follow these 400 patients out, two of them failed stereotactic radio surgery, and two of them failed surgery. So now, the microsurgery people are going to undergo stereotactic radio surgery to solve the problem. And the people who fail stereotactic radio surgery are going to undergo microsurgery. So the groups were sort of matched. In other words, you fail surgery too. So you pay this higher price. You may lose your facial nerve, you're going to lose your hearing at a much higher rate, and your rate of the treatment failing, and you having to have adjunctive treatment years down the road, is the same. What would you choose? I mean, it's pretty obvious. Anyway, this was looking at these patients. There are a couple differences in the groups. If you had surgery, you had a much higher incidence of headache. But look, we don't know why, but those that undergo stereotactic radix surgery get headaches too. And we're not quite sure the mechanism, but now your rate of headache was about 3 times higher if you had surgery. Spinal fluid leakage is a problem unique to surgery. Peritoneal edema was a problem unique to stereotactic radius surgery, so 1.2% of their patients in this study had peritoneal edema, and this one patient was given steroids and it went away. Taste changes or problems with hydrocephalus, a little bit more common in stereotactic radiosurgery. One of these, so there were two patients that had hydrocephalus after stereotactic radiosurgery. One person had hydrocephalus after surgery. And only one of these got shunted. The other one had high volume taps, lumbar taps, and they went away. This one went away with a high volume tap, I believe. Surgical patients get infections, not at a high rate, but they do, and it's morbid when it happens. Diplopia did occur, and it's a little bit unsure why, but diplopia did occur in an SRS patient. Lower cranial nerve dysfunction, problems with 9, 10, and 11 occurred in one patient with surgery. DVTs occur in surgery patients, not in stereotactic patients. Seromas occur in surgery. Not an SRS. So that paper was talking about just strictly things that a surgeon would look at to classify how someone's doing. But the way your surgeon thinks you're doing and the way you think you're doing might be considerably different. We encounter this quite a lot. The surgeon looks at the screws in your back and they're in the right place and the bone fused, and the surgeon's patting himself, him or her, on the back. Oh, I did a great job, but the patients may or may not be happy with their spine surgery outcome. And so this was a study that's for spine surgery, but this was a study that looked at quality of life measures in these patients. And what they did is they looked at those that underwent microsurgery, stereotactic radiosurgery observation. And they even took and they applied some non-tumor controls, so like just people without any problems like this, because they want to see how they did. And basically, those that underwent stereotactic radiosurgery observation reported better pain QOL scores than the patients that underwent surgery. So in general, those patients that didn't have surgery felt better about their life in general. And did better. The PANCL scores, the PIN, Acoustic Neuroma Quality of Life score, is what that stands for. And it measures seven different things. Some prospective non-randomized studies, the POLLOCK study, I think you brought that one up in 2006. SRS had no deterioration in quality of life, whereas surgery, those patients did worse for several months, but then they eventually got back to normal. So, in defense of surgery, it makes you miserable for a period of time, but then you recover. And that's what that study showed. So, surgery is going to make you lose 3 to 6 months of your life. You'll be miserable for 3 to 6 months. You have a higher rate of hearing loss, higher rate of facial nerve injury. Same long-term control of your disease. So these things are accumulated. Study out of 2009, basically those that had surgery felt worse. the Wolbers study in 2013 looked at the review of all the controlled studies. There are six studies that compare radiosurgery and microsurgery in a controlled way. They weren't prospective, but there were six studies that compared them. With SRS, there was no mortality, no surgical or anesthetic complications, better facial nerve outcome, better preservation of hearing, better quality of life. This is what I've just told you. Like, all of the studies are showing the exact same thing. Here's the data from those six studies. Management recommendations. This is, I guess he's now at NYU, Kanzioka. Okay, I don't know when that change took place, but he's a big SRS guy, and he published a paper in 2012, and that shows that over time, even those with normal hearing, vestibular schwannomas tend to grow. They double in volume somewhere between 1.6 years and 4.4 years. Stereotactic radiosurgery will arrest the growth in 98% of patients. If you observe these patients alone, they gradually lose their hearing, and it's typically over the next 5 years. So if you do nothing and you have a little acoustic neuroma, you're probably going to lose your hearing. If you do something, you probably are going to lose your hearing very quickly if you do microsurgery, and maybe over several years if you do stereotactic radiosurgery. And there's another paper published by Regis that he cites that followed, not Regis University, but the last name author is Regis. I can't remember the location. But patients who observe their acoustic neuromas, by 5 years, only 14% of them maintain their serviceable hearing, whereas the rate of hearing preservation in this group was somewhere between 60 and 80% after stereotactic radiosurgery. In other words, five times more people had maintained their useful hearing at 5 years if they had stereotactic radiosurgery. He's a very big pro stereotactic guy. And his argument is on just radiating them, basically. It's not quite, but if you're old or have a lot of a poor life expectancy, then you can watch. And then this is the treatment algorithm that I don't think that we need to go through all this. But conclusions, there's no level one evidence. Treatment is very individualized. And you need to have a discussion, because what you as a patient may bring to the table matters a lot, and you need to have a discussion with your surgeon. If using modern dose parameters, stereotactic radiosurgery is very safe, and over 90% of patients won't have any tumor progression in 10 years. And in fact, hearing loss doesn't tend to be as big of a problem. And I'll know if Dr. Simpson wants to speak to any of this, but hearing loss doesn't tend to be too much of a problem if you control the dose that you deliver. I don't know what you do, Kelly, but you want to deliver 12.5 to 13 to the isodose line at the border of the tumor, and you want to try to keep the cochlea from getting less than 4.2 gray. And in those patients, the chance of preserving hearing is very, very high.